we want to write the system of equations as an augmented matrix and then solve the system by writing the matrix in row echelon form. So the first thing we should recognize is that we have a system of two linear equations with two unknowns. The equations are in standard form, which is the form we need to write the augmented matrix. So using the first equation, the first row in the 2x3 augmented matrix will be 3, negative 2, 4. The second row will be 9, negative 6, 12. So notice how the first column contains the coefficients of x, the second column contains the coefficients of y, and the third column contains the constants when our equations are in standard form. Now to solve this, we want to write the matrix in row echelon form. So we can use this as a guide here, but let's go ahead and review specifically what row echelon form is. An augmented matrix is in row echelon form when the first non-zero elements in each row, called the leading entry, is 1. We have several examples here below. Each leading entry, or 1, is in a column to the right of the leading entry, or 1, in the previous row. And number 3, rows containing all zero elements, if any, are below rows having a non-zero element. So again, there are several examples given here below of matrices in row echelon form, but I also want to mention how if we focus on the main diagonal highlighted here in yellow, notice how the main diagonals often only contain ones, but they can also contain a zero if the system has either no solution or infinite solutions. Next, notice that all the elements below the main diagonal are zero. And this is important because this gives us a strategy to transform the matrix into row echelon form. And we're able to transform an augmented matrix using a process called Gaussian elimination, which means any two rows can be interchanged. The elements of any row can be multiplied by a non-zero real number, and any row can be changed by adding or subtracting the corresponding elements with another row. So going back to our example, we first want to focus on obtaining a zero in row 2, column 1. To do this, we want the terms in this column to be opposites so we can then add the two rows together. And since we have a positive 9 here, we want this 3 to be a negative 9, which means our first step is going to be to replace row 1 with negative 3 times row 1. If we multiply row 1 by negative 3, we would have negative 9, positive 6, and negative 12. Second row stays the same. And now to obtain a 0 in row 2, column 1, we're going to replace row 2 with row 1 plus row 2. So we'll keep row 1 the same for right now. And now for row 2, we'll have negative 9 plus 9, that's 0. 6 plus negative 6 is also 0. And notice how negative 12 plus 12 is also 0. So in this case, we have a row of zeros, which means we'll have an infinite number of solutions. Well, let's finish putting this in row echelon form, meaning we want the first element in each non-zero row to be 1. So we're going to replace row 1 with negative 1 ninth times row 1. Notice that negative 1 ninth times negative 9 is positive 1. Negative 1 ninth times 6 would be negative 6 ninths, or negative 2 thirds. And negative 1 ninth times negative 12 would be positive 12 ninths, or positive 4 thirds. And again, the second row is all zeros. But our matrix is in row echelon form. We're going to write this as a system of equations once again. So this first row is telling us that 1x minus 2 thirds y must equal 4 thirds. The second row is telling us that 0x plus 0y equals 0, or 0 equals 0. So when we obtain an equation that contains no variables, it's either always true or always false. And since 0 always equals 0, this is true, which is telling us that we have infinite solutions. But this doesn't mean that any value of x and y would satisfy this system of equations. X and y are still related in a specific way. So looking at equation 1, notice if we solve this for x, we would have x equals 4 thirds plus 2 thirds y, or 2 thirds y plus 4 thirds. So this equation is telling us that we can select any value for y and then calculate the value of x that would satisfy this system of equations. Often when we have an infinite number of solutions, we express the solution parametrically, and we introduce a new variable so we have an equation both for x and y. For example, notice if we let t be our new variable, where t is any real number, if we let y equal t, we can say x must equal 2/3 t plus 4/3. So even though we have an infinite number of solutions, we can express these solutions parametrically in this form here. For 1 or 2, we can express this as an ordered pair, where the x-coordinate would be 2/3 t plus 4/3, and the y-coordinate would be t, again where t is any real number. So because we have an infinite number of solutions, we can say the system is consistent and dependent. To verify this, let's go ahead and graph these two linear equations on the same coordinate plane. Here's a graph of both lines. Notice it's actually the same line, therefore they have an infinite number of points in common, verifying that our system does have an infinite number of solutions. And any point on these two lines would be in the form 2/3 t plus 4/3, comma t, again where t is any real number. Okay, I hope you found this explanation helpful.